Welcome to the webinar Exporting Exotic Vegetables to Europe, organized by CBI. My name is Thomas Vonk and I'm working for the CBI Market Intelligence team. As you can see and read on the screen, we cannot see or hear you. So please ask your questions using the questions tab. Most questions will be answered in this webinar. We have in between, we answer some questions and at the end, we will answer your questions. A recording of this presentation will be available on our website in a few days, and we will also send the presentation itself to the attendees of this webinar within a few days. Okay, last, please complete our short survey at the end of the webinar. And I will go to the agenda for today. After a short introduction of CBI by myself, I will give the floor to Michel Peperkamp, who is a market researcher for CBI studies, and he will give the main presentation on exporting exotic vegetables to Europe. So at the end, we have some room for answering your questions you have been asking via the question tab on the right of your screen. So please do not forget to ask your questions there. And then we'll close it for today. Okay, first, I'll tell you something about CBI. CBI is the Center for the Promotion of Import from Developing Countries. And our mission is that we support the transition towards inclusive and sustainable economies. For that, it is important for us to create decent jobs and to stimulate a sustainable trade and production. So we are active in 14 sectors. You'll see them here on the screen. And of course, today is an activity, a webinar on the fresh fruits and vegetables sector. And we can start new projects currently in 24 countries. The CBI core competences are that we, when we start programs, we do company coaching, so we support in their export and learning to organizing their export. We give trainings on organizing export and trainings on certifications. We support the government and business support organization in enabling an export environment. We have market entry activities before, so that's visiting fairs and also virtual events nowadays. And of course, we have market intelligence, which on our website a lot of studies. So I will tell you something more about it later. Or now. So we visit you to invite you to go to our website where you can see more information on our programs, Export to Europe. You see all the programs we have or new programs we are going to start. And we have an important part of our website is the market information, where you can see the 14 sectors, and so within the sectors you can look for studies which are of interest to you. So this is the website of the market, cbi.eu/marketinformation. And the study we're talking about today is on the website as well, fresh exotic vegetables. So you'll find the full study on the website. So please visit it. On our website is also an animated video on what market information can do for you. Last but not least, I want to point out to you that we are currently having a virtual networking event, which is a long-term matchmaking event for the fresh fruit and vegetable companies. So we work with that to be to match. So please visit the website. You can find information on it on our events website as well. So cbi.eu/events. And here is the email address for B2Match. You can register there and have more information on this virtual event. you can see exporter as an importer, you can see exporter profiles. As an exporter, you can make your profile and register. So that might be of interest to you for doing business. So now I will give the floor to Michiel. Okay, there you have the new presentation. Go ahead, Michiel.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Thomas. Today I will be presenting something about exporting exotic vegetables to Europe. So we are going to talk about the product definition, which countries can be of interest, the channels, the requirements, how to do business, how to organize your exports, and of course the interesting question, how to find your buyer. So next slide, please. Next slide. Let's use the arrow. Yes. So let's start with the definition of exotic vegetables. Next, please. Because these vegetables, they can include a lot of different products. But I think we should define them as basically as foods that are originally not part of a local food culture. So we talk about, for example, in Europe about okra, bitter melon, various types of exotic chili peppers, and a lot of other products that are not commonly consumed in the European market, which may of course be very familiar products for the origin country, but not for Europe. So these are exotic vegetables. Next, please. And different buyers in Europe, they refer to exotic vegetables in a different way. So some will call it exotic or tropical vegetables. Other will refer to it as ethnic vegetables, referring more to the traditional consumer of the product. Of course, you have a big foreign population as well in Europe. And others will actually use the origin of the vegetable. So they will promote Oriental, Asian, Indian, or African vegetables, for example. So each buyer has its own way to address these exotic vegetables. But both will, of course, use just the name of the product. So if you're trying to look for these types of buyers, you can basically search for all these definitions, and you will find different buyers. And these buyers are, of course, spread out in many different countries throughout Europe. But to define your best opportunities for these countries, it's important to look at different aspects. So how can we define the opportunities in these countries? It's, for example, by looking at the imports, ethnicity, as well as the popularity of foreign cuisines. Next, please. So we start with the imports. We have one statistical code for niche vegetables, and that usually includes products like okra, bitter melon, chayote, coriander leaves, among many others. So this is already a group of products that is niche and that is small. Although its import value to Europe is at currently 120 million euros. So it's not a huge group of products, but it is definitely growing. In the past 5 years, another 10 million was added to the value. And most of the products, they end up in destination markets such as the United Kingdom and France. These are important markets. They have about 45% of the import share from non-European origin, of course. But there are some other countries as well that could be interesting. We have Spain and Italy. These are also large producers of vegetables in general. And we have the Netherlands. And the Netherlands is basically a transit country for a lot of other countries in Europe. So part of the import in the Netherlands, it will be reshipped to Germany, to the Scandinavian countries, as well as Switzerland, Belgium. So basically, you see a lot of import in the Netherlands going abroad to other European countries. So next, the ethnic population, that's the second thing we can look at to define more or less the size of the market. And if you look at ethnic population, of course it's a big diversity, but we see that Germany is quite high in the in ethnic diversity, as well as UK, Spain, Italy, Netherlands, and each country has its own as its own type of population. So if you look at the UK, for example, we will see a large population of Indian and Pakistani. So you can assume that the vegetables that are consumed in these origin countries will also be consumed in the UK. So there's a big ethnic market for Indian vegetables, for example. The same can be said for Spain, where, for example, there's a big Latino population. So a lot of vegetables that are common for those regions will be consumed in Spain. And France, of course, has a good connection, a good link with Northern African countries like Algeria, Morocco, Tunisia, as well as Senegal. And these are people that were not born in Europe. Of course, there's also a huge population of people that have an ethnic background, but they were actually born in Europe. So the population is much bigger than you will see here. And that we can also see in the ethnic cuisines. Next slide, please. So in the ethnic cuisines, we see that, for example, the Chinese cuisine is one of the most popular cuisines in most countries, but also other Asian cuisines, Japanese, Thai, Indian, Vietnamese. So all these cuisines you will be able to find in Europe. And this is a good indication that a lot of these exotic vegetables don't only stay in the ethnic market, but they are actually promoted as well in different food outlets, where also other consumers will get to know these vegetables. So this is an important thing for these vegetables, that they become more or they become bigger by transferring to other consumer groups. Next slide, please. Next, please. Going to the market channels, well, we've seen the countries, Northern and Western Europe are quite big importers. And it's actually the specialized importers and the ethnic wholesalers that are responsible for most of this market. In particular, the wholesalers that import for restaurants, for street markets, specialized shops, online stores. This is a big chunk of the exotic market. The other part is done by importers that are specialized in exotics, and they usually have a better relation with supermarkets, but also a lot of Asian supermarkets where these vegetables are much more common than in the conventional supermarkets. Next slide, please. So basically, the wholesale market is a market that we should not underestimate. And this is an image of the wholesale markets, for example, in Paris, which is Wuxi. But each country has a big wholesale market or several wholesale markets that are quite important for these types of vegetables. So if you talk about Germany, we have about 17 wholesale markets, and several of them have several billion euros of sales in food and vegetables, also on some other products. France, of course, Rouchy, like I mentioned, is an important market where a lot of the vegetables end up. United Kingdom, several markets in London, Spain, Italy, Netherlands, they all have a certain region or wholesale markets that are quite important for these products. Of course, this presentation will be shared with you later on, so you can have a look in detail where these markets are. Next, please. So there are wholesalers, there are importers, and it's a bit of a gray area, of course, because some wholesalers do have imports activities and importers do have wholesale activities as well. But basically we can divide them in more or less two types of companies. One is much more focused on the ethnic market, so there's a high diversity of companies. They usually have a cultural link to the origin country. A lot of these companies are actually managed by a manager with an ethnic background, which is non-European. But the majority also has a low profile, so they can be quite difficult to find. But nonetheless, these are the companies that are responsible for a large share of the most exotic vegetables. Then the other type of importer are usually importers that are more specialized in exotic vegetables, and they have a whole range of exotic vegetables, a broad assortment usually. And these types of companies can be either small, medium, or larger companies. The advantage of the companies is that they have a good link with the larger buyers, like the larger supermarkets, for example. Of course, not all products are sold in these channels. The Netherlands has a specific position for these type of companies because, like I said, the Netherlands is a transit country, so you will find several companies specialized in exotic vegetables in the Netherlands. So of these logos you see, these are all importers, specialists of exotic fruits and vegetables. And I believe five out of these seven are Dutch. So they are based in the Netherlands. And even the Spanish company has CMR, also has an office in the Netherlands. Next slide, please. So starting with supermarkets, of course, these can be very interesting buyers, but only if they are buying the exotic vegetable for their assortments. So mostly you will see types of vegetables like cassava, like certain chili peppers, but it's only a small part of the whole range of exotic vegetables that you will find here. So yes, they're big volume, but it's also a difficult channel to market the most exotic vegetables. So you will find the most common exotic vegetables in these channels. Next slide, please. Then we have cash and carry. These are basically, they look like supermarkets, but of course they're much more focused on the professional buyer, on the professional market. So they focus on catering, restaurants, all types of people that work with food professionally. They usually have a bit broader of an assortment, of course, because they are working with restaurants where you will find a bit more variation. So a lot of restaurants, also normal restaurants, not just the ethnic ones, they experiment with different vegetables. So the assortment is a bit broader, but as well, these are usually supplied by a bit larger importers with broad assortments. Next slide, please. And then, of course, the specialized retail. This is, well, in my view, one of the main channels for exotic vegetables, because it includes Asian supermarkets, for example. It includes street markets, small outlets. And these small outlets you will dominantly find in more like southern European countries. Like the pictures, the images you see, these are shops that you will find in Spain. You can actually find on almost every street corner, you can find a shop with fresh fruit and vegetables. And if you look at the northern European markets, you will see street markets, Asian supermarkets, but also a new development, which is the online sales of exotic vegetables, which you will see in the next slide. Next, please. So this is an example of the company Van Gelder. Van Gelder is actually a Dutch wholesaler, but they also have online sales and they also sell to consumers this way. So you can actually order the vegetables online from different countries. This is a small assortment from Thailand, which includes okra, which includes small corn, baby mice, lotus root. So you have a lot of different types of vegetables in these online shops. And we expect that this online sales, especially in Northern Europe, like the Netherlands, the UK, but also some other countries in Northern Europe, that will definitely grow. And it's a good and easy way for consumers to get exotic vegetables and to get a big assortment. Next slide, please. Maybe there are already a couple of questions. I don't know if Thomas, our organizer, has read a little bit about your questions, which you can put in the GoToWebinar tool.
Hi, Thomas. Thank you. Yes. There were some a few questions which I've already answered. They were asking for the links to the B2Match and the links to the full study. So no other questions. I asked the attendees to ask your questions if you have any questions for Michel. So we will continue his presentation now, and at the end we will answer his questions. Oh, there's coming up a question now. Let's do this question right away, and then we are a startup producers company. How can we enter into the EU market? So this is a startup producer company, and he wants to know how to enter the European market. What must be his first steps?
Well, that's a very good question, and I think it's a question that a lot of producers will be interested to hear. And the second part of the presentation, I will definitely go into that as well. But basically, what I can tell you upfront is prepare for strict requirements of the market. Prepare every detail of your both production and your export, because it's not easy to supply the European markets. I think there are many producers, many small producers, medium producers that are interested in the market, but there are only a few companies that are actually achieving to get to the European market. But of course, there are enough opportunities, because there are also a lot of different buyers, especially in these in this segment, the exotic vegetables. It all comes down to experience, and that you will see as well in my next part of the presentation. Experience is key.
Okay. So, thank you. Yeah.
I don't know if you have another specific question. I hope everything of the first part was clear.
Yeah. He was also telling us that he has already his Global GAP certification. So that's also already
that's a good start. Definitely.
Good start as well. So, and yeah, SDBI on market information offers a lot of information on how to organize your export to the European, and also how to find buyers. I get a lot of questions on here are three questions on if there is a list of European buyers. Okay, I always say, you know, there's no like list. It's very specific, but maybe Michel can tell something about it. How do they get?
There's no such thing as a ready list, but there are definitely ways to make your own list. So and to search for these companies, and that's also a subject that we will touch in the second part of the presentation. Yeah. So let's continue with the presentation. If there are things not clear, then please put your question in the question tool. Because we're going to talk a bit more about the requirements for exotic vegetables. Next slide, please. Starting with the main focus point, which is food safety. Next, yeah, okay. Food safety. So basically, pest and pesticide residues are the main concern for, well, actually any fruit or vegetable, but especially for exotic vegetables, because these are products that have a strict control when they enter the European market. They're usually considered a high-risk product. Often there are pesticide residues or other things wrong with these vegetables. So it starts with a phytosanitary certificate, which is required for practically all vegetables, including these exotic vegetables. And even for some vegetables, there are even more strict or specific regulations within this phytosanitary certificate. For example, for chili peppers, root vegetables. And these controls, these can be strict, but they're also expensive. So they have to be paid usually by the importer when there is a control. And for example, for pesticides residues, there is actually more control for certain origins and certain products. So if you look to the right, you see okra from India, there's a 10% inspection rate. So 10% will be inspected. For Vietnam, this is actually 50%, so it's much, much higher, which makes Vietnam a little bit less interesting for buyers to buy their okra, because they know 50% will be checked and there will be a higher cost for import. So these are important things to take into mind. You really need as a company to have an effective pest control for your products. The residues you can find online on the European website. You can find them in all the studies that we write with requirements. These residue limits are quite low, so it's definitely important to put your main focus on this part of your production. And I would advise you to already test your product in your own country, so you're sure about what you're sending to Europe. So this is definitely your main concern, and the main concern as well of the importer. Next slide, please. But importers, of course, yeah, they have to look at the legal aspect of the trades. But what buyers usually like to focus on, are other things. If you talk about exotic vegetables, because they have other requirements themselves, and probably freshness is probably the most important thing for the buyer himself, besides the legal aspects. Freshness, because a lot of buyers, especially ethnic buyers, they expect a really fresh product. So you also have to prepare for smaller shipments. A wholesaler usually sells to his clients several times in a week. just to be sure that the product is fresh. So there's a continuous flow of these products. Another aspect is price. Even though it needs to be fresh, what makes it more expensive already because it has to be flown into Europe. But price is still an important aspect of this market. And that's usually because the ethnic consumers are focused on fresh products, but they also think the price of the product is still important. A lot of consumers of these vegetables are not necessarily rich people. These are people that love these types of vegetables and they're willing to pay the price for them. But of course, they are conscious about the price and quality that they get. Most of the vegetables will be required or will be in demand for all of the year. So it's good to have a year-round availability. A lot of importers will work with different suppliers from different regions, so they can actually supply these products throughout the year. And of course, we already heard it before Thomas said it, the global gap. Global gap is mainly required, or is especially required if you talk about the conventional supermarkets, then it's basically without it, it will be quite difficult to enter the market, if not impossible. For exotic vegetables, well, it's not always a requirement, but it's definitely an advantage. If a buyer has to choose between two suppliers and one is Global Gap, of course, he would go for Global Gap because it's also a type of security for them. So Global Gap, I would definitely recommend, even for exotic vegetables. Next slide, please. So if you do want to do business with these types of buyers in Europe, what do we have to focus on then? Let's see. Next slide. Basically, in this trade, you will find a lot of small companies, like I mentioned before. And small companies or small traders are not always that formal, which means that a lot of business is done on the basis of a relation and of trust. At the same time, like I said, these products are also high risk. So it's a bit of a balance. You need a high level of trust, and at the same time, well, of course, it's important to formalize your business if you can, but you cannot expect that all buyers will be formalized. So relationships matter, and actually, some buyers I heard saying that the relationship is actually worth more than a written contract. This does not mean that you do not need to have a contract. I still recommend to have one, but relationship is considered to be even more important, especially by these small companies, these small traders. So what a buyer expects from you is that you actually understand the requirements, to understand what it takes to get your product into Europe, to understand what it means to have an active policy on pesticides and know what you're doing. So buyers prefer suppliers with experience in Europe. And once you have a relationship, you can build on it. And there are people that have been dealing with the same suppliers for more than 20 years. And for them, it has actually become less necessary to look for new suppliers because they have built this relationship. Relationships matter. Let's look at the next slide, please. So what importers do if they want to find a new supplier, they will usually check your company details. They will ask for photos of the products, maybe a sample. But they will also check if you already are experienced in Europe, and some will even check your reputation with other importers or other wholesalers. So these are things that your buyer would actually focus on. They would probably start small with small shipments, see how it goes. And there are actually some buyers that would transfer just the whole financial risk to the supplier, especially if they don't really trust the trade yet. Then for them it's just easier to transfer the risk. So as a supplier, what you can do, because of course you have in Europe as well, you have good companies and bad companies, and there's a big gray area of companies that, you know, they can be excellent relationships, but you should not trust all companies either, or their handling. So what you could do as a company, at least, is to see if a company here is registered. All companies have to be registered. There are different databases of Chamber of Commerce where you can find these companies. That's a basic thing, because if they're not registered, it means the business is definitely informal, and maybe a company is not even paying its taxes. So it has to be registered. You can also find out how many years it has been operating. Usually you can get a larger profile from these databases. You can find out a bit more data. If a company has been around for 20 years, it makes sense that they may be trusted a bit more than a company that has been around for half a year or 1 year. I know there are also people that will start a company, and if it goes back, they will let it go bankrupt and start the next. So those companies are definitely not the companies that you want to be dealing with. Well, in these databases, you can also ask sometimes for financial data of the company. See if they have credit, if they actually have enough means to pay the product. So you can check their credit worthiness. You can do that as well through an insurance company or a credit rating agency. And what I usually do as well, I usually check the physical location of a company. Sometimes these companies are located on wholesale markets, which is completely normal. Sometimes they have an office, they have their own logistical company with a warehouse. But there are even companies that are just located on a residential area, a residential house. So, you know, there are differences, and if you can find the location or you don't trust the location where they are, that's another sign for you as a supplier to be aware. And in the end, if you're not sure, you know, always work. Although it's not common to work with a bank guarantee, but you can also ask your buyer to pay for your product upfront. So next slide, please. Paying upfront is for some buyers it's normal, not for all buyers. So there's a lot of different options for purchasing and payment conditions. In the end, it's a bit of a game. Who needs who the most? What is your power of negotiating? And that's a bit of a game. It can also start with one agreement and then develop to something else. I talked with a buyer, and he said, well, the first shipments, we might pay up front, but then we would ask for a credit, and the first credit would be 7 days, and then if you build a relationship, we ask for a credit a bit more ample, 14 days or 21 days, and this gives a bit more room to your buyer that he can, you know, buy and sell the product as well. But this is based on building the relation. Usually prices are fixed in this segment. For other products, sometimes you have like a minimum price guarantee and account of sales or commission sales, but not as much in these exotic vegetables. These are more fixed price. So yeah, documentary credits, they are not really used because they take a lot of time. They're expensive, especially for small shipments by air. It doesn't make much sense. So you have to see what is working for you as well, and then I'll discuss the details with your buyer. Next slide, please. So like I said, the trade can be informal, which can also be a risk. So my recommendation would be always to work with a written agreement, or at least put something in writing, because this will definitely help you when you have a claim, when the quality is not good enough, or when pesticides are found, or whatsoever. It will back you up if you have to get into that discussion. So always write something down, and preferably work with general conditions of your buyer. Maybe your buyer has one, or maybe you have one. Start with small shipments. This will reduce your risk. Of course, if you send by air one pallet, that's quite different from sending a whole container, a full container load, which can, well, if there's a claim and your buyer rejects it, the loss is a lot bigger, of course. And like I said, if you don't trust it, look for prepaying clients, clients that actually prepay the product before you send it. Although it may narrow down your market because not all buyers like to do that. Next slide, please. Well, luckily, the informality has its advantages as well, because we have a lot of different communication tools nowadays, which are quite different than the old days. And WhatsApp has actually become a preferred tool for most of these buyers. For them, it's really easy to get messages on WhatsApp, because, well, usually a manager of a company, like a small company, is running around checking products coming in, getting in touch with his suppliers, his clients, maybe selling as well in the wholesale market. So he has a lot of things on his mind. So it's a lot more easier for them to get a message on WhatsApp, or get a confirmation of the product, get some pictures, and then respond when it suits him, when he has time. So for them, it's the ideal way to communicate. So it's definitely important for suppliers as well to use WhatsApp. Maybe not for the first introduction, but once you're dealing with a buyer, then it's definitely has its advantages. Next slide, please. Going to the next subject. Organizing your exports. Well, talking about logistics, insurance, packaging. Next, please. Exotic vegetables. Yeah, usually they are small volumes, of course. A lot is air freighted, just because, you know, it needs to be fresh. So logistics has to be efficient. Preferably work with direct airlines, direct flights. No stopovers, just to maintain the cold chain, which is really important to maintain the quality and the freshness of the product. For sea trades, well, you can sometimes mix loads, mix different products in one container. As long as they don't affect each other, then it's a good way to save cost on the logistics. And always, of course, check the Incoterms. Your Incoterms will not protect you against non-payment, but you still have to check them in combination with the payment conditions. Incoterms, you know, it tells you when the product is transferred to the customer, and when the responsibility is transferred to the customer. So basically, if you ship FOB, which means that as soon as it's on the ship, your buyer will be responsible for the product. He will be owner of the product. But if he doesn't pay the product and he says something is wrong with it, he might blame you as a supplier, even though something might have happened on a ship. So it's really important to understand these Incoterms as well. Usually for air freight, CFR, cost of freight, is used. And for other shipments by sea, it can be a variation. It really depends on your buyer. Understand that a lot of these buyers are quite small, even they lack some knowledge about these logistical terms. So then it's even more important for you as a supplier to do have this knowledge. I would recommend having at least some export training before starting your export of your products. Doesn't matter if you have an excellent product or not, you need to have some basics in exports. So next slide, please. So who's responsible for the insurance? Insurance can be definitely recommended for larger shipments by sea, full containers. Of course, because your risk is a lot higher. When it goes by plane, you know, it's usually pallets. You can insure that as well, of course, or calculate the risk of something going wrong during the transport. You can always use insurance. You can also use export credit insurance, and that will ensure you that your buyer will definitely pay for the or is able to pay for your product. And these export credit insurance companies, they can also help you check in the credit worthiness of your buyer. So that's an extra convenience that you can get from these insurances. It depends a little bit who's responsible for the insurance, but always make sure that it's clear who's responsible for the product, who's responsible for the insurance, you or the buyer. Next slide, please. Packaging, there's not much I could say because there's such a wide variety of products. Mostly these products are packed in small boxes varying from 2 kilos to 5 kilos. What can be interesting to mention is that once a product grows bigger and gets its entrance into larger supermarkets, then you can find all kinds of other packaging options, which you can see already for aubergine or eggplant, common eggplant at least, mini vegetables, as well as certain beans and peas. These are semi-exotics, I would say, and these can be packaged in different type of consumer packaging. So that can be an option if you're working with a vegetable that is soon entering the regular channels, that you can add additional packaging options for your buyer, making your company maybe more interesting. Next slide, please. Of course, the most interesting questions that everybody probably has been waiting for, it's about finding buyers. And this is basically the question that I hear most from suppliers from outside of Europe. And there are several ways that you can find your buyer. I will get into a couple of ways to do that. First of all, of course, trade fairs are still one of the principal sources for companies to buy or to find their associates, their partners. This is both true for importers and exporters, I think. even for exotic produce companies. These companies may not have their own stands, or they may not be an exhibitor on these big fairs. But they are definitely there, and they definitely use these fairs to get into contact with new suppliers as well. So what you can do is definitely visit these fairs. If you're capable of exhibiting, of course, that could be another option, although it may be a bit expensive for small traders. The main fairs I would recommend are Food Logistica in Germany, in Berlin. This is the biggest fair. for all fruits or vegetables, including exotics. Another one could be Food Attraction, which is organized in Madrid in Spain, which is also gaining more and more importance in the last years. And you can use the exhibitor lists as well. So you might not find all the interesting visitors for these fairs, but you can definitely scroll through the exhibitor lists, and there you will find a lot of different names. And I would recommend you to plan a visit, make meetings, schedule meetings before visiting. So it will be interesting for sure. Next slide, please. Something that is quite important for typically this segment of vegetables, the niche and exotic vegetables, it's basically putting your name on the box. It's as simple as that. A lot of wholesale buyers and a lot of wholesalers that are working wholesale markets, they have all their products on display, including the cases, including the boxes. So basically what a lot of wholesalers admit to do, they just walk around and look at the boxes for all our wholesalers, see who is supplying them, and then they have a new potential supplier, they have a name. Remember that experience really counts doing business in Europe. So if they see a name on the box, what that tells them as well is that you're experienced. You already sold something. So that's a big plus, and this is basically a quite an important way to get your name, to get your company and your products more out there. So definitely think about promotion on your boxes is also really, really quite important. And of course there are other ways. Next slide, please. Because, well, everybody has internet. You can search for websites, but it means that your buyer will do the same. Some buyers, they say, well, sometimes we just search on the internet for new suppliers. We get names from the internet. So if you don't have a website, well, how are they going to find you? Another way could be LinkedIn. As well as member list of wholesale markets. So the wholesale markets that I showed to you earlier, a lot of them have websites, and several of them also have lists, a list of wholesalers that are selling their product on that wholesale market. You can scroll through these member lists, pick a few of those names, see which one is interesting for your product. And contact those companies. It won't be easy to really get into contact sometimes. It takes several phone calls, mails, but if they're interested, trust me, they will definitely ask for more information. So it's both making yourself findable, but also be proactive in searching for different profiles at wholesale markets, at trade fairs. So no, they're not ready lists of these companies, but these lists you can make yourself by looking for these places, wholesale markets and trade fairs. So you use your tools to find established companies, but you also increase your own visibility online to attract new buyers. Next slide, please, because you can also do this in LinkedIn, and I gave just a short example of a company in India, and they present themselves quite well on LinkedIn. They have their profile on LinkedIn, and they have more than 2,000 followers. So this is also a way to increase the visibility of your company, and it's also a way to find other professionals. So these followers, they all have their profile on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is quite popular in Europe. I can tell definitely in the Netherlands. Almost all people, all professionals have a profile on LinkedIn. So this is that would be an easy way to contact people as well. So let's go to the summary of today. The next slide, please. I wanted to summarize a couple of the tips that we discussed today. Starting with the first one, most importantly, just get experienced. Try to start up your market entry small. Try to get that experience, because that will definitely help you further. A lot of buyers are not waiting for new suppliers without any experience, without any compliance. They will not be interested. So get experience. That's the first step. Like I said, be visible, visit trade fairs, put your name on the box. Your product is basically your business card. So if your product isn't good enough, if the quality is mediocre, it will not do a lot of good things for your company. Yeah, you have to have your name on the box, but also the product in it. It's what you represent. And how do you maintain quality for your products? That's through maintaining freshness, efficient logistics, and a perfect cold chain. This is really where you have to think about and invest in. Once you've done that, you can build on relationships. Relations are really important. Always use clear supply conditions and contracts, but don't forget the relationship that you have with a company, because these are valued probably even more than the contract that you have with them. And just make sure that your product is good before shipping it. Make sure it doesn't have any pesticide residues. Make sure it doesn't have any pests. Make sure it's the quality that is required by your clients, and always communicate. Tell your buyer what is going on. If you want to read a bit more about all these things and requirements, also for other fruit and vegetables, you can also always refer to the website of CBI. We have all the studies published there about exporting, buyer requirements, all kinds of tips on doing business, as well as organizing your exports. So please check the website as well, and I'm sure you will find all the information you need. And maybe after today you have questions, so I will refer again to Thomas to see if there are any questions that we can respond on.
Yes, thank you, Michel. There are a lot of questions. We're asked in the question tab, so I'll select. We can answer most of them, I think. The first question I want to ask you, Michel, is someone is asking, what is the importance of branding when entering the European markets, or are non-branded commodities the way to tap into the market?
Well, if you talk about branding, having your own brand name for the product, it can be both, depending on the type of buyer that you're working with. Because if you brand a product, you can link the brand to a certain quality. That is basically branding. You want to brand your product if you want to have something exclusive. And that would definitely work with a lot of buyers that are looking to distinguish a product. If you want to build a reputation, and if you want to get your target markets familiar with specifically your product. So it's definitely a good idea. But there is also a group of buyers that would not like to have any of it, which is basically, now of course there are also companies that are doing business with clients and they want to put their own sticker on it, or they want to put their own brand on it, or they don't want their client to know where he is getting his product, so he doesn't even want your name on the product. So it really depends what kind of buyer you are involved with. I think as a supplier, if you have the means for it, you could always do both, supply exotic vegetables without any brands, and have your own line, your own brands, for all the types of buyers that could be interesting in that. But it will take a lot more time, efforts, and investments to launch your brands. And I would definitely also recommend it to do it together with a relation in Europe, because it's much easier to get it promoted through a partnership. So yeah, both can be an option. Just, you know, be aware of the impact that it has on your company of introducing a brand, which will not be easy, but of course it can be interesting.
Okay, thank you, Michel. Another question from Suhali is probably responding to something you said about a half an hour ago in your presentation. Is a 10 to 15% inspection rate of every shipment, question mark, on or on average, question mark? So
no, it's yeah, of course, and I understand the question. It's about the increased inspections on certain origins, certain products. Yeah, of course, the inspections will be selective, so it will not be 10% of each shipment. It will be 10% of all the shipments coming in. Otherwise, it would be 100%, and the authorities, they don't have that kind of manpower to inspect 100% of all the shipments that come in. So it will be 10% of the number of shipments. So not every shipment to every buyer will be checked.
Okay. A question about the global gap. Will global gap stop to be in a to be a requirement according to the new income terms update from 2020?
We're talking about income terms, and we're talking about global gap.
Yeah, the Alberto is asking there are new income terms. There's an update on the income terms in 2020, and he's asking if a global gap will still be a requirement.
Well, to my knowledge, Incoterms and global gap are two completely separate things. Incoterms is all about the logistics, about the responsibility and the transfer of the product. Global gap is something completely independent from that, and global gap will not go away. It will actually become even more of a requirement, I believe. It's already 100% required by all conventional supermarkets, but also a lot of other channels. It will become just more and more important to have global gap. So don't expect global gap to go away. Expect it to become more important, actually. And I don't think it has much to do with the new Incoterms.
Okay, thank you. Here I have a quite specialized question on okra. I'm not sure if you're able to answer that, but maybe Michel knows a lot. What's the best size required regarding the okra? We have three available with different shapes. Is there in Europe any preference for size and shapes in okra?
Yeah. Well, we focused on this study on exotic vegetables in general, so we haven't dug out all the details of all the products. What I can say about okra, at least there's no official market requirement or market documents for okra, but I would say there can be different requirements for different sizes, and that will depend a little bit on the end market, the end consumer. It's all about what they want to have. So I think there should be a market for all sizes, depending on the buyer that you're working with. But this is something that you really have to discuss with your importer, with your buyer. I think size would be inferior to freshness and quality. So I can imagine if one size is just not available in the market, buyers will also be flexible and go for a different size as well. So yeah, it's something that you really have to discuss. There's no official requirement for it, for as I know. But yeah, discuss with the buyer.
Okay. I have a question here. Is there a demand for EU organic certified fresh and dried vegetables like ginger and turmeric? Who are the main importers to Europe? So yeah, like ginger and fresh ginger is like a fresh vegetable, and turmeric. Maybe I can answer first, and then Michel can add something.
Sure.
Because I'm the market intelligence for natural ingredients as well, and I know for turmeric, especially organic turmeric, it's in demand and it's a growing product. So for natural ingredients, mostly in the dried version or powder. We have a special study on turmeric as well in the natural ingredients page from Market Intelligence, Market Information. So please check that. And maybe Michel can say something about fresh ginger and the organic version of that. Do you know something about it?
I can do both, because the turmeric, it is actually one of the products that you see more and more often in conventional supermarkets as well. So yeah, it's definitely an interesting product. Yes, there's also opportunities for organic, at least in turmeric. Because it's also considered a healthy product, so health and organic, you know, they go together quite well, and that's probably the same for ginger. Ginger has been around for a lot longer, at least in the conventional channels, so consumers are more familiar with it. So turmeric is quite new for a lot of consumers, but it's definitely growing. And for both, I think organic is definitely a good option. Normally, I would say for a lot of vegetables, especially for the ethnic vegetables, organic is not a big issue. It's not a big market either, because you're already in a niche, and then organic is another niche in a niche. So I would not recommend it for a lot of ethnic vegetables. And a lot of ethnic consumers, they're not looking that much for organic either. But if you talk about ginger and turmeric, yes, I can imagine there should be opportunities. And talking about buyers, yeah, there are different kinds of buyers. I think there are several exotic buyers of exotic vegetables that have a broad range. For example, in the Netherlands, you have Nature's Pride. They have a big range of exotics. They may have some organic as well. And you have other specialized companies, really specialized in organic, so both organic and some exotics. I can try to give a few names, maybe a company like Josta. I'm not sure if they have those products, but they really focus on the social aspects and organic. You have OTC, which is really focused on organic as well, and I believe they have a broad assortment as well. So yes, there are several companies that are focusing on both organic and exotic vegetables. For the other companies out there with an exotic vegetable which is not marketed in conventional channels such as supermarkets, I would stay away a little from the organic market. But for turmeric and ginger, yeah, there's definitely a market for them.
Okay, thank you. We have a question. Somebody just wants to know more about global gap. He wants to have more explanation on global gap. maybe we can just point out where he can find more information, because I don't think it can be said in short time.
Yeah, well, I'm not a global gap specialist, to be honest about that, but it's you can find a lot of things on the websites. Google global gap and you will find them. Basically, in every country, there should be global gap consultants and people that can help you to a global gap certificate. It's all about environmental compliance and social compliance on the productive stage of your product. So it's not that much focused on export. It's really focused on the production of your product. So yeah, definitely find someone in your country that can help you getting the global gap certificate.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, what is the most common mode of transport for exotic vegetables? And what is the current situation in logistics? Also referring to the high container prices at the moment. I'm not sure if that is mentioned by the question, but yeah, what's the current situation in logistics and what's the current mode for exotic vegetables transport?
Yeah, well, of course we had a big dip in 2020 for several exotic products, but that was also due because a lot of restaurants were closed. But also, yeah, the logistics, a lot of airlines stopped flying, and airlines is definitely an important way to transport your product. I believe it's a much better now, the situation concerning air freight. But of course, there are a lot of countries which still have to deal with quite high air freight. Although I was surprised to hear from a source in India that the air freight was not that expensive. It was actually I think €2 or €2.20 or something, which is not bad for air freight. But yeah, air freight rates has been rising. If you talk about container logistics, that can be interesting for the a bit bigger exotics that are that can be transported for a longer time. What I've heard in the market is that especially the Asian routes can be difficult to get containers, and it's also quite expensive. It has become quite expensive. But in the end, yeah, we can all be concerned about the container price, about air freight prices, but in the end, the market will have to pay for it. You just have to be sure that your product will arrive in time, which can also be a challenge these days, because I think all the planning for the containers, it's quite mixed up. So you really have to put your foot on the logistical service provider. And make sure that he's able to get your product in time to the market. I think that will be a big concern. And yeah, the higher rates, they're there. I know that. The market knows that as well. And people just try to find the best possible ways. So yeah, it has become more challenging.
Okay. Next question. Where was I? Yes. Okay. Yes, that's also about thinking paying. Okay. What safeguards are there for exporters against dishonest buyers? So, like dishonest exporters in developing countries, there are also dishonest buyers.
Definitely.
So, what should they do about it, or what safeguards are there for dishonest buyers?
Well, there are bad buyers in Europe. I can confirm that. But there's also a big gray area, and I think the gray area is even much bigger. So even a good client can do a bad thing. it's we're working here in a fresh trade, so a lot of things can go wrong. And especially with exotics, which is a high risk product in many aspects. If it's a company that is trustworthy or has been trustworthy with your company and has done good business with your company, you can still have a claim or a discussion. I think the most important thing is to try to solve the problem together. Be honest on your side, but also ask the same honesty from your buyer. If you talk about companies that are just there to with a quick win and they're not there to do business, they just, you know, they want to they want to gain profits despite of everything, those are not the companies that will be around for a long time, I would say. And yeah, how can you check if they are trustworthy? Like I mentioned, make sure that it's a registered company. It would be nice to have a company that has been around for several years. But also look at the location of the company. Are they working from a home address, which is much more informal, or do they actually have a place on the wholesale market where they operate? So these are all different aspects. You really have to see for yourself if you think a buyer is trustworthy. And like I said, most buyers will be in a gray area. Good buyers can still become bad buyers. But that's inherent to the business as well. It's a fresh product, so a lot of things can go wrong. You're always welcome to check with me as well, and I can help you check your company. But yeah, that's basically what I would recommend.
Okay, thank you. So we're running out of time, but there are some questions left, so I don't think we can handle them all today. With regard to the previous question, there's also the question, someone wants to know, can you explain how CFR works with air freight? There's CFR, I don't know if she mentions cost freight or cost insurance freight.
Yeah, cost of freight. Well, cost of freight is basically the same for air freight. It's as a supplier, you're responsible for paying the cost of the freight, but it doesn't include in insurance, so that's a different aspect. I would recommend to go to the International Chamber of Commerce, go to their website, and there you will also find like there's a big diagram, and it shows exactly who's responsible for what part of the logistics and who is owner of the products. So that's a good way to orient yourself, I think, on different Incoterms. That's all the Incoterms there. So I would definitely recommend to get that scheme. And see about the different options.
Okay, ICC, thank you.
International Chamber of Commerce.
Okay. I think we're going to the last question, and this is a nice closing question, I think. How can we build trust with buyers if you are new in the international market?
Yeah, good question. How do you say that? Make sure that you are supplying a product that is continuously a good product. So it's all about continuation. It is not an option to send one product one time and the other product the other time, or one quality and then another quality. So if you have a constant quality and you prove, you know, it's always the same good product that you can supply, that will build confidence. And then if something goes wrong in the future, whenever, then the discussion is much easier because your buyer knows that he will always get a good product from you. And if there's a time that your production didn't turn out well, or it's not what you expected, it's probably not what your buyer will expect either. So just be honest about it and tell him, listen, we produced this year, but the quality is not as good as usual. And just to be honest about it, that will get you a much further in building a relationship and getting the trust, the long-term trust of your buyer. Sell what you have and don't sell something that you don't have. And be good in a continuous way with quality and compliance.
Okay. Thank you, Michel, for answering all the questions and for your presentation. And I want to thank all the attendees for listening to our webinar. I hope it gives you some good information to continue your business and start new businesses. And we'll hope to see you next time. We're planning a new webinar for the fruit and vegetable sector in November. It will be on our website shortly. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you. Thank the participants.